Hello, everyone. On today's edition of The Final Bar, the market pulls back, reacting to the weekend news, the overnight news about everything going on. And so stocks coming down a little bit. We're going to have a segment called Shifting Stocks. We're going to look at which names are working, which names are not, and a lot of them pulling back to key support levels. So it's identify those lines in the sand for some of the stocks that have been strength that are starting to ease off a little bit. My guest is Mark Ungewitter from Charter Trust, a fantastic guest with a good long-term perspective. Ladies and gentlemen, this is The Final Bar. Hey, welcome to today's edition of The Final Bar. Really appreciate you joining us every weekday here on StockCharts TV to take stock of what's happened in the financial markets, connect it to the long-term trends, get a good long-term perspective of what's happened. No better day to try and do that than today, where we have quite a bit of distribution leading after the news over the weekend, all the headline risk, all the challenges coming out of China, the viral outbreak, and just how investors are grappling with that, with the expectations and how they're evolving. So what we're going to do today is look at the short-term movements, look at the gaps down we've seen in a lot of stocks today, and just try to put it in proper context. One of the questions I got overnight was, where do you see things headed? Like, after a big jump like this, what's the objective? And hopefully we'll be able to fill in, answer those questions together over the next 28, 29 minutes or so today. My guest in a little bit is Mark Ungewitter from Charter Trust with some really good long-term charts of the market. I think it's so helpful in a day like today when you have a lot of short-term fluctuations, a lot of earnings risk with some big companies reporting this week, Apple and so forth, making sure you understand the long-term trends. And I think Mark will help us to do that very, very well. Coming up, I did want to point out some of the things that we have coming up on the show over the next couple weeks. So if you're thinking of tomorrow, we have Dana Lyons from the Lion Share Report. He is going to be sharing his take. We also on January 29th are unveiling our new documentary style interview with Ralph Atkinpour called 50 Years on Wall Street. Fantastic view, which you're really going to enjoy. The next week, we're actually going on the road to Atlanta and to Orlando. So we're going to interview some fantastic strategists. We're going out to Elliott Wave International, some other places in the Atlanta area, and then we're going to finish off in Orlando at the Money Show. We'd love for you to join us there in person or through some streaming options if you check out the Money Show website. So a lot of really cool content coming up for you. We, however, need to move right on to the market recap. Let's talk about what's happened here. So, clearly when you're looking at any equity-related thing today, there's a bit of a gap down. During the day, sort of had this big gap down in the morning, sort of morning to lunchtime. We had a bit of a recovery kind of coming up to what ended up being the highs for the day. But as the session went on, you sort of sagged down a little bit. And if you look at the intraday chart, this is the last 5 days, 5-minute chart of the S&P 500, the spiders. You can see this move higher and then the rotation down after lunch. And again, if I think visually of what a dead cat bounce sort of feels like or sort of looks like, it's kind of like this chart. You have the big jump down and then sort of the continuation lower. So not exuding a lot of confidence, especially going into the close. There's certainly some supply than demand here is what the chart is telling you. Certainly a lot of fear that's manifesting it on the chart. But what does that mean for the S&P 500? Well, as we've talked about for a number of weeks now, right, a trend is formed not by day-to-day movements, but by a number of days sort of strung together, right? So as long as the stock market continues to make higher highs and higher lows, by definition, the trend is positive. Now with this gap down on Friday, we talked again, we had sort of this really distributive pattern. We've certainly seen follow through to the downside today. And now we're sort of getting near those support levels that we talked about. We said 3210 or so would have been support. That comes from the end of last year, first week in January. That's sort of where the most recent swing low. And don't look now, that's about where the 50-day moving average is going to end up over the course of this week, most probably. So we're sort of right at that key support level. The other thing to note on the S&P 500 chart, again, so quickly the picture has changed, but with this big move down, you have the RSI getting below 50. And in general, again, in a bullish phase, you'd expect support around the RSI 40 level, and you certainly wouldn't expect it to get much below 40, because that's in a bullish environment, that's where things tend to hit pause. We're going to talk in a little bit about some of the stocks that are showing that are shifting stock segments. There are a number of them that are pulling back to their 50-day, an RSI pulling down to 40. Like, that's sort of the time when stocks would kind of bottom out. So I think we're at a really interesting point here where either something like 3210 on the S&P holds, the 50-day holds, and this is the next pause before a new leg up, or we start to break further down, and then you have to start going a little deeper into potential support levels. And at that point, when that happens, we'll start bringing up Fibonacci retracements, looking at further support levels below there. If we would get down there, I think visually you have to go down to this 3090, 3100 level, which is where we found support after that last big move up in October, November of last year. This is where we found a lot of support. Call that a demand area, an area at which buyers would most likely come in. That's kind of here. But again, that's a pretty big drop from where we're at right now, especially with how sort of slow and steady this uptrend has been. So that's sort of the high-level view. Let's look at some of the short-term reads and see what sort of things we can find out. The S&P was up about a point and a half. Sorry, there's a little bit of a glitch there with the percentage, about 1.5% down. But then you can see that mid-caps down a little less. Small caps down actually the least. So small caps ended up being at the higher end of there, which is a little different. You'd probably expect them to sell off a little more. So a little bit of a transition there. You can see in terms of sector rotations, we have utilities, real estate, consumer staples. So the real defensive part of the equity market up the most, or down the least, really at the top end of the return list, almost flat for the day, down about a quarter to a third of a percent. Big losers were energy, and we have a huge sell-off in commodities, oil, many others, except for the, you know, sort of precious metals, things like gold, down big today, and that's what's certainly causing things like the XLE to come down pretty dramatically. Tech actually number two from the bottom, which is sort of a very different environment, right? We sort of have the ME trade, the late cyclical leadership at the bottom, including technology, which has been leadership up until now. In terms of industries and what sort of movements we've seen, I think it's worth noting that there were some industries that were actually up. And I can tell you, on a day like today, when it feels like everything is down, remember, not everything is down, okay? There are certain things that tend to do okay. And in today's move, in a sell-off environment, you have home construction, non-durable household products, then some materials, containers, packaging, mining, gold mining. So these are all groups that were actually holding up just fine. At the bottom of the list, you have things like energy, oil, equipment, and services. Gambling stocks obviously hit very heavily by what's coming, what's happening in China, and sort of speculation about luxury travel and so forth. I think it was also worth noting semiconductors, one of the worst groups today, top 10 on the bottom of the list out of 60-odd Dow industry groups. So, you know, a real differentiation with energy, tech, a lot of materials weighing down on the downside. But again, certain things that were up, okay, home construction, metals mining actually doing just fine. Pharmaceuticals also on the list there. I did want to just very quickly point out before we move on to our next segment, a couple things. You know, the breadth picture I think is going to take quite a downturn. I color coded the small cap breadth in the form of percent of stocks. This is cumulative advancers decliners. I color coded it orange on my weekly review over the weekend because it was just hitting that sort of sideways point. I think what's going to happen once the closing levels lock in is a lot of these are going to potentially break to new lows and probably give them more of a neutral to negative tint to them. I did want to point out finally before we move on, consumer discretionary versus staples. We saw today staples, one of the top groups, consumer discretionary about in the middle, the equal weighted consumer discretionary versus consumer staples. We had this on our 3 and 3 on Friday. It is broken down with the sell-off that we have in the markets today. So overall favoring defense versus offense in the consumer sector. I want to move on to our next segment, which is shifting stocks. So what I love to do is look at individual names and how they're fluctuating. This is a segment that tries to capture more of a stock picking mentality. And as I've mentioned to many of you, I mentioned on the show before for sure, one of my weekend routines, I try to do it every Sunday evening, is go through all of the S&P 500 and just look at the charts individually. I do it by sector, and I try to group them within the industry groups within each sector. And if you do that consistently, even if you can't do it once a week, that's okay. Do it once a month or even once a quarter. You will find over time, over a series of weeks, a series of months, you will see how those charts evolve. And you won't get caught off by broad market movements because you will have seen the signals in the short term, in the individual stock charts. So what I wanted to do was just go through some of the names that I jotted down as I was reviewing charts over the weekend into this morning, which charts jumped out at me, which ones I thought were notable. And we're going to start with communication services and go through some of the consumer sectors, and then we'll see how far we can get. Got about 20 tickers I was jotting down randomly as I was going through the list and finalizing it this morning. This is Comcast. So we have the challenge in the media space and communication services. A lot of the jump down. This is with the news from Netflix last week on, you know, talking about streaming subscriptions, what that might mean. Disney selling off a lot of names, all sort of pulling back in relationship to that. I just wanted to look at a couple of them. What's interesting about the Comcast chart is the fact that it's just testing this support. It's just below the 50-day today, has not broken down through the 200-day. It tested it back here in mid-December. And so, again, it's right at sort of this confluence of support when the RSI is right around 40. So either, again, this is the beginning or sort of the next, you know, rotation higher, and you can see that the RSI has sort of hit bottom around here a number of times for the last 8 or 9 months. Either that trend continues or we start to break down. I think if we do break down, if charts like this break down through the 200-day, down through the 50-day, the RSI gets below 40, that tells you there's a much different character than we've necessarily seen. The challenge with the chart of Comcast and with some of these media names, so look at the relative strength. It just really hasn't been a big relative winner because some of the other groups like tech and elsewhere, insurance names, for example, all breaking out or in pretty good shape relative to some of these. Let's look at a couple other really quickly. So within that same group with Comcast, you have things like Fox FOX. Same thing. This is sort of pulling back to the 50-day. This is a little different because it's back to the low from the beginning of January. So again, you know, if I didn't know what was going on the world, had no idea what the broad S&P chart was doing, I was just looking for stock ideas. Not a bad chart because it's right at a previous support level, right at an ascending 50-day moving average, the RSI just above 40. Actually holding up okay, and you can see how that changed from August, September, October, when it was more depressed. Now all of a sudden we're in the bullish range for RSI, holding up okay. Relative strength a little flat, which is, you know, again, a bit of a concern, but overall, on an absolute basis, holding up okay. The last one here is VIAC, which is Viacom CBS. This is a very different character because it's broken down through the mid-December low, now testing sort of this all-time low here from the end of October. But look how oversold it is. It's almost a potential double bottom pattern. So this is certainly more of a bottom fishing candidate. But if you buy in on the thesis that the reaction to the streaming challenges was a little overblown and that these stocks are potentially at value levels, and something like VIAC may potentially bounce up from there. Let's switch gears and go through some of the consumer names, a number of things just randomly that hopped off the page. We talked about Viacom, CBS just a second ago, testing support. Interesting for me to see that GM was in a similar sort of condition. So again, I am not a value investor, but if you are, charts like this might be of interest to me. It's oversold. It's at the level where it's bounced before. If you look at the RSI levels, it's back to the previous lows from October, not far above the real long-term low at the end of May, beginning of June, before it outperformed a little bit. So potentially, again, it's been an underperformer, but, you know, really at these depressed levels, and at the very least, you could ride a bounce a little bit higher. But again, I personally would want to see some sort of accumulation before I got too excited about it. Also within consumer, Amazon is obviously the big name. It's a huge weight in the XLY, and a lot of the view of consumer discretionary is going to be expressed in this individual chart. Again, we sort of have it pulling back to an ascending 50-day moving average, also just below the 200-day, the RSI just above where you might expect support. So I think Amazon is at a crucial, crucial point. And again, either this sort of level holds, the moving averages hold, the RSI holds, or it breaks down to, but we're sort of right at that point. Other names within consumer, I thought it was interesting to see Nike gapping down right to the 50-day, but accumulation right through the close, closing back above 100. This thing was down to 90 earlier today, but then look at this accumulation. So that is the type of thing I would want to see if I'm long something. You'd want to see buyers coming in and wanting to accumulate more on weakness. So overall, sort of the uptrend still holding some pretty good shape there. Let's see. We also have Lowe's, same thing, pulling back to a 50-day with some nice accumulation off of there. Under Armour was another one, sort of in consumer discretion. This one's a little different because this one is more of a symmetrical triangle or sort of a pennant pattern. So you've had this nice run hitting the 200-day, hitting resistance. Now you have lower highs, higher lows. So this has to resolve one way or the other. Either we break above 22 and go to new highs, or we break below 1950, we break to new lows. But on a chart like this with the RSI right in the middle, it tells you we're in a coil pattern, in a sideways pattern, and I would want to see which way the momentum goes. And John Bollinger always talked about lightening of volatility, a compressed level before we have a meaningful breakout. I think you want to watch which direction that things go. Those things go. Also, just very quickly in consumer discretionary, you have the home builders, all of which, talk about all these charts we look at, charts that look very different. Home builders are it. So DHI, Lennar, Pulte Home, all really constructive, overbought, if not extremely overbought, and breaking new closing highs, new relative highs on a day when the rest of the market is down. To wrap up the segment, I just wanted to hit on a couple charts in random other sectors and consumer staples. I mentioned that ratio is favoring staples, and there are some names that are actually starting to improve a little bit. Something like Campbell's Soup has held up very, very nicely. The RSI is in a bullish range, and the relative strength starting to turn up a little bit. Hormel is another one, ticker HRL. So this is one that, you know, again, looks just very constructive. You wouldn't know that the market's in a bit of a panic. If you look at this chart, it actually looks sort of long and strong up and to the right. Pretty healthy move. I do want to point out, obviously, with tech leadership, you have to pay attention to the big tech names, and things like Apple reporting this week are going to be huge. And either there's good news that comes out of this sort of earnings report or challenging news. And I think Apple has been the poster child for an extended bull market with no issues to worry about. Do we see this thing sort of break down? It's so far above the 50-day, though, that I think it could pull down quite a bit without any issue. You know, to wrap up on something like Apple, I would point out, if you look at Gaddis Rose's chart, and sorry, I'm just going to take one more second here. If you look at Gaddis's chart, this is his chart style. He does a great job of showing all the relative movements between groups. What concerns me is Apple's group has outperformed broader technology, and Apple as a stock has outperformed this group. So the biggest name in tech, the huge market cap stock, Apple, has done very, very well, which means technology could sell off, but the chart won't look that bad because of a big stock Apple that's still holding up on a relative basis. So interesting theme going on a pretty big earnings week. We need to move on, folks, to a commercial break. We'll be back in a minute with my guest, Mark Ungewitter from Charter Trust. We'll see you in a minute.
I was staring at the north wall of my barn.
Okay.
It's plain and boring. It's this whitish color. Mm-hmm. It's 70 feet long, it's about 18 feet high, and just blank. And I said to myself, you know, 2017, I'm going to be 50 years in the business. Wouldn't it be cool if I could just put the history of the stock market? That's where the idea came from. I wanted to capture my 50 years.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the show, The Final Bar. Thanks for joining us every weekday after the close to break down the charts, break down the news and the events of the day from a technical perspective. I want to bring on my guest, Mark Ungewitter. Mark's from Charter Trust. A very knowledgeable market strategist. I would label him respectfully a technical analyst. And I love the two long-term charts that you share with us, Mark. Welcome onto the show.
Hi, Dave. Thanks for having me.
So the first one you sent is very interesting. It's looking at the S&P 500 on a very long-term view. We're going back to the 1920s. What is this telling you in terms of where we're at relative to the long-term trend?
Well, I think it's a good day to look at long-term trends. We've been tactically bearish for the last 2 weeks based on extreme sentiment, and we're looking for a correction, maybe 5 to 7%. It's really hard to say. But we have had we did have a powerful breakout in November. What this chart is telling us is we labeled December 2018 as a cyclical bottom. And this is a price moment. There are many ways of viewing this, but this is a price momentum chart. We're looking for moves below more than 5% below the 200-day moving average, followed by move more than 3% above. And that's what those red flags are. And so they're a confirmation of cyclical bottoms. We had one in 2009. We didn't know it was also a structural bottom. We had one in 2011. We had one in after the bottom in 2016, and then in April of 2019. Of course, there were other indicators, breadth thrust indicators, that occurred as early as mid-January. But the point here is we're in month, if this is the case, we're in month 13 of a cyclical bull market. And the shortest cyclical bull market in the post-World War II era has been 18 months, and that was the from the bottom in October 1998 up to March 2000. So because of that, we think that this is likely to be a normal correction and not a cyclical top. We think that the market is maybe mid innings. Rule of thumb, and you can see that there's no symmetry here, there's no precision, but rule of thumb is 3 years up, 1 year down. So ideally, we'd be looking for a top in mid 2021, maybe as early as late 2020, maybe near the election.
It's very interesting, and you know what struck me as you were talking, Mark, was, you know, you mentioned like a 5 to 7% pullback, which seems rationally seems pretty normal, but boy, after a slow and steady uptrend that we've had for a while, that actually is going to feel a lot more painful than I feel like 5 to 7% really should feel, right?
Yeah, the early volatility and the late volatility seem to feel the heaviest.
That's right. Now, I wanted to pivot because the second chart you sent was fantastic, looking at long-term interest rates. So obviously, we have this, you know, this juxtaposition of stocks and where they're headed, but then, you know, bonds and stocks have been outperforming bonds for a while now. What is this chart of the 10-year yield leading you to think here?
Well, it does hinge a bit on our equity view. So you've had an 8-year-old range here. If you see that triple bottom, and currently that yield's down near 160 today, not 180. But we're more inclined to respect this range and think that maybe what we're seeing here is a retest and probably not a breakdown. And again, it does hinge a little bit on the equity view, which is also a view of the business cycle, I suppose.
It's very interesting. And you think about, I mean, one of the challenges that I've had talking with some investors is, you know, what so many of them have not had experience in a rising rate environment. I feel like as many people have been learning to invest, it's been in a period of lowering rates. So if we do have sort of a rising rate environment, if the triple bottom holds, if we get, you know, back to the upper end of that range, what would that lead you to do? Where should investors be looking at that point?
We'd probably be looking to buy some bonds if we were in the upper end of that range and we felt that the cyclical bull market in stocks was mature. We think that in bonds, we think that we had, as it says in the text there, we think we had a cyclical bottom in yields or a cyclical top in bonds in late August 2019. And that was with Alan Greenspan and, you know, and the negative yield scare. But more because we were near the bottom of that range. The lag, we went and looked at the lags because August 19 versus December 2018 pivot for stocks was 8 months, and we found that in recent cycles that for stock, for bonds to lag. The last case was a top in the January / February bottom in stocks versus the July 2016 top in bonds. So the lag is normal. We'd like to respect this old range.
So I'd love to just go back very quickly, if we could, to that first chart, Mark, just to wrap up the discussion. You know, what I love to think, what would tell you on this chart that you're wrong, or what would be a signal telling you that the correction is not happening, or, you know, that it's going to be more sustainable? Is it a price breakout? Is it a sector theme? Is it previous leadership that emerges? What would sort of tell you that the outlook is not what you would originally suggest with chart number one here?
Well, there's a couple things that would. It's really hard to say. I think you'd have to see some lower lows and some lower highs, maybe below the 200-day average. Even though that's not a rule that could be cast in stone. It could be that we have a new benchmark with a 13-month cyclical bull market. But we're trying to stay with a thesis, and then evaluate the data as it comes in. But that's a really good question. I don't have a specific answer for what would make it wrong.
Well, I love that approach, Mark. I mean, generally, the investors I have trusted and gotten to know the best are the ones that do exactly what you suggested. They have a good sense of where things are headed. They have the playbook, but then they're ready and prepared, mentally prepared for something different to happen, which is great. Listen, Mark, those are two fantastic charts. Thanks for giving us a proper long-term perspective on things, and thanks again for coming on the show today.
Great, Dave. Thanks. Glad to do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Mark Ungewitter from Charter Trust. Two fantastic long-term charts. And again, I think there's a theme that I sort of unofficially have created with my guests. I don't know if it's whether I'm picking the right guests or they're just picking up on where I want to go, because they tend to come with great long-term charts on things. And I think it's a great reminder, especially on a day like today, to make sure we don't get too caught up in the short-term sort of flickering ticks of the market activity. We folks, however, need to wrap up the show for the day. We're going to go right into the 3 and 3. So at the end of every show, 3 charts in 3 minutes. And if these are not on your radar yet, they should be from this moment on. So the first chart is China, right? Ticker FXI. And we've talked about this a number of times just as the news has come out of China, just thinking about what it means from a technical perspective. Again, there are plenty of places to look at the news, look at speculation. You should consume what you think is appropriate there. My goal here is think from a visual perspective, from a technical perspective, what is the data telling us? I thought it was really interesting to note, with the gaps down that we've had over the last couple weeks, especially going into today, you can see we pulled right back to the 38.2% retracement level. This is from that original sell-off from May down to August of last year. We then came back, retested the highs earlier this month. We've come back down, and now we've gone right down to the 38.2% level, just above $40 on the FXI. We've accumulated, you know, nice accumulation, nice bounce today, people buying in on the weakness. And the question now is, which is happening? Does this continue? Do we continue to see distribution back down through the Fibonacci support, back down through the lows from the beginning of December? Or do we come back above the 200-day moving average? We're back below the 200-day for the first time since the beginning of December. So one of those two things has to happen. Either we break above 41 or we break below sort of 39.70 or so. And I think the direction of that is going to tell us a lot about where China and other related charts might be going. I would remind everyone, we love to think, is it going straight up or is it going straight down? We sort of think in a binary perspective. I would remind you, there is a very painful third direction called sideways, and a lot of times charts can do that a lot longer than you might want. So there are a lot of levels within this range that we've set that could certainly be of interest. The second chart is offense versus defense in the consumer space. We looked at this earlier in our market recap, and I would point out that the equal weighted consumer discretionary has broken down through the equal weighted consumer staples, which is new. That has not happened in quite a while. And again, you have some big names that have a big weight, things like Amazon and others, but on an equal weighted basis, sort of minimizing the impact of those, and you're just showing that the average discretionary stock is now weakening relative to the average staple stock. The third chart on our three and three is commodities. We didn't look at any commodity charts really as part of our recap. Didn't really make time for it. But I think it's interesting to notice on the GCC, which is more of a sort of an equal weighted commodity index instead of things like the DBC and the CRB index and others that you might be familiar with. This is more of a broader measure of the average commodity versus strength there. So it's not overweighted to energy. I think it's interesting to know that the RSI is just at the 30 level, just at the oversold level. So it's more in a bearish range, but right at the oversold range. So it'll be interesting to see if we see a similar bounce to what we saw earlier in 2019. And ladies and gentlemen, that is our show, a quick run. Boy, when the market sells off, there's so many cool charts to look at. I'll have fun the rest of the week looking at them with you. I want to remind you, keep your questions and your feedback coming to thefinalbar@stockcharts.com. We'll do a mailbag segment soon. For StockCharts in Redmond, Washington, I'm Dave Keller. Have a good night.